Moscow is definitely the place to be today. It's like Tokyo 15 years ago or Los Angeles 25 years ago. It's where you have, it's like the Wild West. You have businessmen, mafia, designers, architects, techno music, a true, genuine renaissance. And it's like if suddenly they were opening the window and they don't know how to cope with freedom. Fairground is full of technology, but a kind of retro-futuristic type of technology, what I like very much. I remember when I was looking through the windows of my grandparents' flat, where these fairgrounds used to be installed every year. These people are really true artists, street artists. I mean, and you can smell the activity. It's full of smells, full of colors, full of lights and sounds and circus music and all these kind of strange, very romantic, gypsy type of attitude and approach to life. And I think my work is certainly been influenced by the circus life or fairground life. I remember when I was a teenager, I've been absolutely impressed by an exhibition from a French abstract French painter called Pierre Soulages. And it was in the Museum of Modern Art in Paris. And I was about 14, 15, and I was totally impressed by these paintings, all black and white, and dealing not with colors, but just with textures and layers of textures of paintings. And when I first put my hands on the synthesizer, on the electronic instrument, I suddenly realized that for the first time in music, you could act as a painter with frequencies and sounds. At the beginning, I started with anything I could grab that could be electronic. It could have been an old tape recorder or an old radio playing with frequencies. I remember that one of my first work had been done with an old radio, and I was going to the short waves range and grabbing, recording this strange electronic sound and playing with it. I used to start mixing this kind of weird electronic sounds with when I was playing in a rock band. It was called the Dustbins, very punk at that that time. In my band, I was mixing electric guitar and organ and flutes and all kind of things we could use in pop music these days, with this kind of strange sounds that I was recording, slow down or speed up, and also playing reverse by reversing the tape, and all kinds of things that you now are using as a day-to-day process in electronic music.
So at that time, I'd been engaged by Francis Dreyfus for doing artistic direction in this company. And of course, right away, I told him about Jean Michel Jarre and how unique that artist was, and that he was not ready and he needed money to construct a studio, to buy synthesizer.
Chatting with the guy, I just realized, because he was very confused for me, that synthesizer was not really a gadget, but he convinced me that it will be the instruments for the end of the century.
I've been one of the first in France to develop the idea of a concept album with French singers and musicians such as Christophe and Patrick Juvet and Françoise Hardy. So I wrote some songs, sometimes only music, sometimes only lyrics, sometimes both. I've done quite a few hits by writing lyrics, and then I've been more and more involved into instrumental music. So maybe in the third part of my life, I will put some lyrics on the music I perform, maybe.
We began working on his first Oxygene album, so I went to his studio in Paris, It was a small studio with minimal equipment, an 8-track recorder, small mixing desk, and only a few synthesizers, and it was the very beginning.
Sound of Oxygene certainly is coming from the fact that I had that kind of minimalist way of recording and minimalist way of considering textures from one to another. The ocean against rocks or the wind against wood. I've always been influenced by the chemistry of nature, sound-wise.
To tell the truth, I'm passionate with music. And with electronic music, I'm not so sure. But with Jean, you know, it's something completely different.
People did not want to accept it for a very, very, very long time. They did not want to accept those types of instruments as being kosher, literally. They said they are not a musical instrument. So in a sense, you know, you're sidelined from the musical industry practically. You know, sort of a little box of your own. Synthetic music, beware. It was very much that for quite a long time, quite a long time.
When synthesizers came out and drum machines, very few people knew how to use them to make symphonies like what he did. Most of it sounded very mechanical, very technical, very raw. It didn't have human spirits in it.
Well, I'm not sure when I first became aware of Jean Michel's music, but I know which pieces it was. Equinox and Oxygene were the first of his recordings, and he may be annoyed when I say that they're still among my favorites.
When I listened to Oxygene nearly finished, I had a big argument with Jean Michel. And I made a big mistake because I told him it would be a big hit. And you will sell 5 million records. We sold, you know, 10 million.
It's really strange that most of sci-fi movies in the 60s, 70s, electronic music was linked with sci-fi. I never considered it was a necessary link. The fantastic exception of that is 2001. I mean, 2001 is probably... it's not only a movie, it's a kind of... opera, audiovisual opera, that really influenced me a lot.
I was delighted to know that he had received inspiration from 2001, and I, in my turn, received inspiration from him, and I acknowledge it. I played his music a great deal when I was writing 2010. I've just heard that he's planning to do his biggest concert yet in Moscow and to have a link up with the space station Mir.
When I first came to Moscow with, being asked by the city of Moscow to do this outdoor concert for the celebration of the 850th anniversary of the city, it seemed obvious that the university site would be ideal.
The problem is when you have security and we all...
What's really different in this country is nothing is logical or straight. Things can happen, but they may well not happen at all. I try not to think too much about it, because otherwise it's the most scary thing, the most frightening thing about a project you're working with and you're living with day after day, night after night, and maybe on the last minute something will happen. Maybe this concert won't happen.
I think Jean-Michel is a raving mad megalomaniacal dictator when it comes to his art, and of course he shares that with any other good artist on the planet. Anything that he does, the kind of things he does, it's just opposition all the way. I'm always awestruck by people like him. He's like Christo, that kind of artist, people who can push to do the most improbable things in the face of the most ridiculous amount of opposition.
This first experiment in Place de la Concorde in Paris was really with the idea of getting some visual track with the performance, with electronic music, trying to find a visual correspondence with what I'm trying. I didn't know exactly what I wanted, but I knew that there was something between, again, land art, street art, hijacking a place, involving architecture, environment, in a kind of outdoor situation. In a sense, it's also a French tradition to have music outdoor and kind of audiovisual type of concept outdoor.
And I remember I was with Jean-Michel on stage, you know, 2 hours before the show, and we were hide behind the synthesizer because he has a huge numbers of synthesizer, Mellotron, you know. And on stage, you know, Jean-Michel looked at above his one of his instruments and he told me, "Oh, look, I don't believe, what is that, you know?" And I look and I say, no, it's impossible, you know. And I saw the Champs-Élysées, and suddenly you had the feeling to have a pot of ink, you know, like that. And it spread, you know, above a table like that. It was like that. I said, why is black like that? I told Jean-Michel. He said, I have no idea. He said, do you think it's the crowd?
We had no idea that it was going to happen like that, because it was... He was just giving a concert, right? It was the 14th of July, and he got all his instruments around the obelisk in the Place de la Concorde. We could not get in, because we'd left it too late. We didn't know. We had no idea the crowds were going to be like that, and the whole of the Champs-Élysées was blocked. Everywhere's blocked completely. It was really sort of the beginning of the beginning of what his concerts then became, really.
Out, and I've been terrified when I realized that what was an experiment for me gathered a million people.
Mick Jagger was there, and I remember he was talking to Jean-Michel, and he told him something like, "Guy, you know, I never saw that in my life, you know." And we were quite impressed, you know, Mick Jagger, you know, it was the big guy, you know.
Each of the albums are specific, but I think that albums such as Oxygene and Equinox, because of this approach with the analog sounds and the fact that I can work with in a very physical way, sensual way, have been really something really special to me. And I would say also Zuluk was an album very, very special that, I mean, entirely based on sampled voices and vocals. I got the idea to involve Laurie Anderson, being a big fan of what she's doing, and I said it could be interesting to create together a language that has absolutely no meaning, but has just feelings. I travel all around the world to steal voices, vocals from Eskimo or Romanian or Russians or Chinese people, and I really mix them exactly like you are mixing instruments, in a sense. And now I'm going to steal some inspiration. I love rats. My Chinese sign is rat, so I feel quite comfy. I'm always excited by the contradictions of conceptual art. It's a cheaper version of Gone with the Wind, in a sense. There is a kind of challenge there, to try to make a steamroller fly. In a way, a kind of familiar challenge to me. I mean, the China project came from, first of all, the British Embassy in Beijing gave to the Chinese radio Oxygene and Equinox. And Oxygene and Equinox have been the first music ever played in Chinese radio after the Mao's time.
Most of them had not heard music for the last sort of 30 years of any kind, except perhaps a bit of classical music or the traditional, you know, Chinese hymns. Jean-Michel and I literally just sort of went there, the two of us, and because he decided that he wanted to do a concert in China. And it was sort of the most extraordinary concert because it started from literally nothing. It started from just a man with an ideal and an idea who wanted to make his music be heard in China. The first concert in Peking was extraordinary because it was in a very big stadium. It was all the officials that came, first of all, the officials and the politicians and the army. And nobody clapped or made any noise at all.
I think the crowds in China were quite nonplussed by the whole thing. It was so full of technology that must have been totally alien to them. And even the level of sound, nobody in China at that time can have heard music performed that loud, even if it had been classical music.
The reaction of the Chinese when they watched the concert was really very weird, because we didn't know before, but when they are watching a concert, they walk, they discuss between themselves, and if it's a bit like if there is nothing happening on the stage.
I remember the first night we had a lot of official people and not so much people in the street, so we decided to buy the tickets. I mean, to buy the old tickets was not a big deal because it was like a few hundred dollars. And we gave these tickets to the kids in street. So the second night we had the real audience, and that has been something extraordinary. I mean, it's an extraordinary experience. So it's like playing on a different planet, like on Mars, on the moon.
Shanghai was absolutely, they just went wild. Because he thought maybe the Chinese were like this and maybe they'd never, you know, they didn't know about what you were supposed to. I think it was embarrassment, too. They didn't know what to do after a concert, you know, it was sort of. But Shanghai, I mean, they didn't know. It was straight from the heart.
Suddenly they start to be very excited and all that. And as an audience, it's the most extroverted audience I ever experienced. I remember in Shanghai, Chinese people, I mean throwing other people, throwing people in the air. I mean, throwing people like this. I mean, like you would throw balls or balloons. They were throwing other guys. I mean, like, it was really mad. I mean, it's like a kind of Rio or Brazilian type of event. I always felt that music and architecture are very close because of dealing both with time and space and environment. I really can't stand this kind of universal concept. In every single town, you have this same bloody architecture where people are totally depressed and in such a drab environment. Why is it always the same old story that urbanists and architects are suddenly deciding that people should live in these ugly, dreadful buildings? It could really be, I mean, a kind of real audiovisual concept, very simple, I mean, to integrate in an architectural concept at the beginning by, for instance, having the facades of the buildings changing depending on the seasons, on the time of the year, by projecting images of any kind of images. It could be images from nature, from day-to-day life. It could be funny. It could be like, like penguins walking, like cows smiling, or whatever. I mean, being surreal, being, trying to be, to have a kind of more organic approach.
Suddenly, we receive a phone call from somebody in Houston who was the musical director of the Opera House, you know. They have to celebrate, you know, the 150th anniversary of the city.
But why doing a concert in the middle of Texas? I don't see the point, and I was involved in other things and musical point of view. And finally, because the guy insisted, I went there. And I just suddenly fell in love with this skyline. I mean, it was a mad palette, a mad canvas. And I said, there is a real statement to make by mixing music with architecture in a very modern way and using state-of-the-art technology in a country bigger than real. I mean, it was the whole thing in Texas is almost too big, and the city, the skyline is absolutely amazing. The NASA Space Agency got involved because it was their 25th anniversary. We got the idea to create a link with space, with the astronauts. And my first contact has been Bruce McCandless, this brave man who has been the first to walk on space unattached. And he got the idea to involve one of his best friends called Ron McNair, one of the astronauts supposed to go in the next mission. Ron used to be a jazz player, sax player, and we decided that I could write a piece. I'm going to write a piece for him, special piece for him, and he could play this piece in the weightlessness of space. I remember just before takeoff, Ron calling me in Paris, saying, "Everything's ready. See you in a week time. Watch me on television for the takeoff."
1 minute 15 seconds, velocity 2,900 feet per second, altitude 9 nautical miles, downrange distance 7 nautical miles.
And then Challenger exploded, and I was so depressed.
Hello, you know, we received a phone call from Houston that they say, you know, it's terrible, you heard the news, it's terrible, maybe we have to cancel. And we say, yes, of course, we have to cancel, you know.
And the astronauts called me, and Bruce McCandless called me. He said, you can't stop now, because it has to become, this concert has to become a tribute for all the astronauts.
The concert went ahead, but they had a substitute saxophonist who played a very moving piece. A tribute, a radiant elegy. It's one of the most moving pieces of music I know, a tribute to the crew of the Challenger.
I will really keep always a bit of Ron's smile and Ron's face in my heart. My mom used to be in the resistance, and she did great things during the Second World War that she'll probably never explain really. But she's been caught three times by the Germans and in the jail in France before she went into a concentration camp.
Jean Michel, bien sûr, m'a souvent interrogé sur ces moments de la guerre, mais parce que je n'en parle jamais. Mais c'est comme un fil rouge quand on tire, et quand on commence à vous en parler, tout vient. Alors je lui ai bien sûr raconté des choses. Et il s'est toujours beaucoup intéressé, c'est forcé. C'est comme un roman.
She met amongst other people one very interesting woman called Mimi Ricard.
Et elle a fait tout autre chose. Elle a eu, je sais pas, un héritage. Enfin, elle a pu acheter ou louer le chat qui pêche, rue du chat qui pêche.
Et elle a monté une boîte de jazz qui est devenue la meilleure boîte de jazz de Paris.
The Fishing Cat. I used to go there with my mom very often during weekends, and I discovered jazz like that. And I remember that, I mean, Chet Baker sitting me on the upright piano and playing for my 10th birthday. Even when I talk about this today, I still can feel the hair of the instrument on my chest. It gave me this idea that music can be descriptive without lyrics.
Straight away, when I first started working with him, he was called upon to do a concert for the Pope in Lyon, in his home city, in 1986.
The whole thing was a mixture of a kind of provincial mood with a kind of high-tech. Huge projections were happening on these old buildings, all the churches over there. The Pope was in this cathedral just on the top of the hill. He actually opened the concert by blessing the city.
Benedicat vos omnipotens Deus, Pater et Filius et Spiritus Sanctus.
And the concert started by actually involving the old architecture of the hill.
It was a very, very, very moving show, that. Because of the Pope, because it was an Indian summer, the weather was absolutely extraordinary. There was a very, very, very special feel about it.
Lyon was a bit magical in a way. I remember that there were candles on the windows and the projections on the houses along the river was something we hadn't experienced before.
So we are here in Lyon, in a place called Cour de Verdun. It's opposite the railway station, and it's where I used to spend 6 months per year, the first 8 years of my life. This is actually my grandparents' flat. And it's where, for me, where all began, in a sense. My other musical link with this place is probably circus music with this kind of street band, accordions and all these kind of street instruments that I think really gave me the envy and the idea of trying to maybe one day express music outdoor. My father was, at the beginning of his career, a percussionist. He used to play for a troupe, a famous troupe of theatre in France. And then he moved into composing soundtracks. Then he moved to Los Angeles. It was always difficult for me to, when I was a kid, to have fun. I was a happy child, I mean, with a lot of energy and all that, but with this kind of sadness somewhere. And I think this sadness was also coming from the absence of my father, because I didn't see my father almost between 5 and 18 years old. And you know, whatever happens then in your lifetime as an adult, even if you understand, you respect, you, and I respect his work, and he's my father, and I accept this, but something has been probably broken forever.
Mener de front des études musicales sérieuses, parce qu'après il est allé au groupe de recherche musicale de l'ORTF, chez Pierre Schaeffer, où il s'est initié aux instruments qu'il emploie maintenant, les synthétiseurs. Et il s'est passionné.
Pierre Schaeffer was the head of what we called in French the GRM, the Music Research Center.
He was the first and the only man that Jean Michel Jarre can think he is a father for him.
The idea that Pierre Schaeffer taught me, the difference between a noise and a musical sound is your intention. Any sound could be music. I mean, like knocking or hammer against a table, or the rain against a window, or the noise of a car, of a machine. If you put it in a different context, suddenly it can become music.
I think you'd have to look back to the 60s and the time when Jean-Michel was a student in Paris, and there was a lot of idea of performance art, public art, a different way of approaching music.
Contrary to the image he has, he's continuously doubting himself, continuously doubting his music, his performances. Today, and probably till the end of his life, he'll only have achieved, in his mind, 30% of what he thought he could achieve. He's a perfectionist.
The mood was very strange because the preparations took a long time, and Jean-Michel was fighting with many, many problems.
It has been probably the most rewarding experience. I mean, to be able, against everything, against the weather, against everything, to be able to do these concerts.
For the concert in the Dockland, there was a lot of problems. Nobody before had made a concert in this place. Everything was destroyed. There was a lot of problem of security.
Docklands was certainly very wet, certainly very fraught, certainly amazing that it ever got underway.
I decided to go to see Robert Maxwell because Jean-Michel needed money to close the sponsoring. And he asked me something very funny. I would like the rights, I would have the rights of the pictures for my company, for my newspaper. And I tell him it's impossible because the rights already deal with Sigma, which is a very famous company in France. And he says, oh, it's a pity. What's the name of the company? Sigma, I tell him. Sigma, Sigma. He goes to the secretary, Sigma, it's mine. And the secretary said, yes, sir. Oh, no problem, Sigma is mine. I have bought 1 month ago.
I'm probably one of the biggest fan of Hank Marvin. When I was a kid, I was playing all Shadows tunes. I suddenly got the idea to involve Hank Marvin into a special song and tune I could write for him. I called him in Australia because he's living in Perth, and he was actually playing the tune. We played together. I was in this room, and he was in Australia, and we just played like kids through the telephone.
His musical composition and the musical aspect of his career is entirely solitary. And the concerts and all the other outside productions, he's always in an entourage with a lot of people and milling and brainstorming, etc. So there is this sort of dichotomy of the solitary musician in the studio to the very public man surrounded by the best possible technicians, experts in all fields.
I will remember a few things I would like to quote. First of all, the British audience. I've been so moved by these people waiting for hours with plastic bags in a freezing wind, in pouring rain. It was really like shooting Apocalypse Now in one night. Princess Diana attended to the concert, and particularly now it's even more moving for me on a personal point of view when I think about this concert. This young, generous, beautiful, smiley face of Princess Diana, it's forever for me linked to this project.
One big disappointment about a project that didn't happen was in Mexico, Teotihuacan, that Jean-Michel was going to do for the eclipse of the sun.
The idea was to do a concert during in the darkness, but at noon, during the eclipse of the sun, at between the pyramid of the sun and the pyramid of the moon.
For obvious reasons, we could not contemplate changing the date by a week or even 24 hours.
Well, the stage was a pyramid, and it left France and then England by boat, and the boats sunk in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean.
We had sent our crew out, we had done our site recognition, we had worked a year and a half on the project.
I recorded special music with ethnic musicians and with Aztec and Maya old ethnic instruments linked with computer music.
And 3 weeks before the show, the bank installment that we were waiting for didn't arrive.
That was a big disappointment, yeah.
And the next eclipse will be in 2136, so it will be a little bit too late for all of us.
It's such a shock for him not to get what he wants.
I couldn't cope with Mexican food for 2 years. I've been really influenced by Russian music, Russian instrumental music. It's also not a coincidence if we are in Moscow, because the first electronic instruments, one of the first ever produced, ever conceived, is the theremin. That has been done by a guy called Leon Theremin, a Russian guy, in Moscow in the early 20s. It's a very simple instrument, but also very difficult to play, because it has two antennas. One is for the pitch, the other one is for the volume. I'm really intrigued by this instrument. It's fairly different from the theremin we know.
This is only one. In this studio, Theremin used to work in 1960s.
Yes.
And actually, at that time, the electronic music in Russia was almost forbidden. Right away, they put him in the prison, and he spent some time in Siberia, and then he worked about almost 30 years for Secret Institute for KGB as an electronic engineer.
No, I think what's really amazing with this instrument is the fact that it's the first electronic keyboard, in a sense. Having each note being amplified separately with a different speaker, yeah. So it gives you this kind of movement in space, and you have a speaker for each note.
Yeah, that's true. That's
so when you play, it's a... I felt quite at home in the Theremin Institute. It reminded me of my own beginnings when I started to work with the first electronic instruments. As you travel through Moscow, you still have the feeling of being followed. The old KGB rules still seem to apply. The citizens of Moscow, their faces, their attitudes show people that have been through a lot. I wondered how a man such as Theremin has managed to stay faithful to his musical beliefs after so much personal repression. I met Peter Minshall in Trinidad. He's a kind of young genius of doing costumes and setups for opera, classic opera. And the way he creates costumes and creates characters is absolutely unique. The first thing he's done for me was for the concert La Défense. I was working on this project called Waiting for Cousteau. Cousteau's boat, the name is Calypso, so I got the idea to do a song that could be called Calypso, and I brought this steel, crazy steel band, the real heavy metal symphonic orchestra, on stage with Peter Minchell's characters that he designed specially for the event.
I've seen Jean Michel's concert in Paris with the planes, with that fantastic event. I wanted to do the same thing for Moscow.
It's my first time here in Moscow, but the rule book is that, like, there's no rule book, really, so you just deal with whatever confronts you.
I think that this concert is the most difficult one because of the size. This kind of stage, for instance, is the biggest stage that we can find in Europe.
Moscow is very different from the other part of Russia. Some people even say that it's a state within a state. It is very different. The level of life, salaries, the amount of money that is in Moscow is very different from what we see in Russia.
I'm delighted and honored to have been invited by Mr. Lushkov and the people of Moscow to commemorate the celebration of Moscow's 850th anniversary.
Начнется это удивительное, великолепное, необычное и очень редкое лазерно-музыкальное шоу Жан Мишель Жар. Прекрасного композитора, человека, который своим творчеством предлагает нам взглянуть в 21 век.
Жан Мишель is a very much hands-on person. He has his dream, and he actually probably wouldn't trust anybody else to really carry it out for him except himself.
We're just starting to get all the different elements of the show kind of organized and everybody, every department in sync with each other, starting from the top of the show and working our way through.
Que les écrans ne viennent pas gêner la passerelle. Donc au niveau de chronologie 6, les écrans, c'est le moment où c'est un des seuls moments où je vais pouvoir me mettre là et là. C'est le seul moment.
We've got tonight and tomorrow night. Tomorrow night's the dress rehearsal. But after that, we can still work on correcting things.
He's involved with, I would say, everybody in the team. I mean, he's very involved with the graphic, with the laser, with the light programming. He's very involved. He will stay overnight and he gives his own feeling about the light, the programming and everything. And you can see him working almost a mile away with listening about the PA.
Alexander, could you help me? I would like to explain them. That I would like to hold the note a little longer for the end of the previous song.
There is some light that we can't put on the roof, so we are obliged to lift it with the helicopter. And for the moment, with the helicopter, we expect it at 2. To be honest, we expected also the helicopter yesterday at 2. We expected the helicopter this morning at 9. Now it's postponed, and I think we will have it at 2.
If the children are going there or there. They're not going to be visible because you have the lights are there for this.
I thought it was a sort of logical step for Jean-Michel to be in Moscow now. And what he did with that is he didn't push it at all. He didn't push it at all. He said, it'll happen, it'll happen. I'm not going to push it, I'm not going to do it, I'm not going to control it. If Moscow is to be, it'll be, and that's how it happened.
Jean-Michel's very particular with the things he eats and drinks and the way he dresses. In preparation of a big concert, those little idiosyncrasies become more apparent as sugar in the coffee and Diet Coke and his socks and the sneakers he wears and little things like that, which suddenly become more obvious the closer you get to a big event.
Surtout, je l'admire. Franchement, je l'ai toujours admiré. Et pour sa concentration, quand il fait de la musique, il est dedans, complètement. C'est un personnage qui met son corps presque dans toutes les notes de ses musiques, quand il est dans la concentration absolue.
Jean-Michel is someone I admire because he has a lot of energy about what he has to do and he doesn't hesitate to spend hours and days and months on his projects and doesn't stop until it's really finished, until the last moment.
Yes, rendez-vous deux, rendez-vous two, picolor second, part two.
Trombones also?
What?
Are the trombones supposed to come?
The trombones should be here any minute, so we have to do it. Okay.
Jean-Michel, my dad, likes to have a grip on everything. He wants to control all the little details. He thinks that 2,000 different things at a second. He sits down, then he thinks of something else to do, and it's kind of rush, 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 which is normal because it's such a huge project.
Yes, because it will be too dangerous for the light because we were running late. No, you will be stage right.
The concert begins in exactly 2 hours, 45 minutes. We still have about 1 billion problems.
Something changed suddenly with my relationship with a lot of Russian people. This mixture of land art, street art, rock concert, multimedia event, it fits with somehow with the Russian mentality. They are very committed to the project because they feel that it's not just my project, it's their project. I always presented this project as a project that couldn't be achieved without them. And by the end of the day, I would say that, in a sense, the star is not myself. The star is Moscow.
Between music and pictures was really thin. This was the reason I decided to explore a kind of multimedia language, linked together by my music dealing with time and space. We'll be right back.
been lots of suggestions for celebrating the new millennium. And one I've put forward, which no one has saluted yet, is really inspired by Jean Michel. Could we put an image on the moon by powerful lasers so that when you look up in the sky in the evening, you see the little crescent moon, and on the darkened surface, say a child's face to herald the birth of the next century, the next millennium?